سلام به برنامه یه نان گل سرخ این هفته خیلی خوش آمدین. من فریبرز پویا هستم.
سلام به همه گی دوستان و مریم نمازی هم.
در برنامه این هفته میخواستیم در رابطه با مرگ ناگوار سحر خدایاری صحبت بکنیم، دختر آبی و اتفاقاتی که در هول هوش این قضیه افتاده.
مصاحبه این هفتمون با ویدو ویتز، ایشون یک کمدین در یوتیوب است. با ما باشید جنگل.
جهان از خبر مرگ و خودسوزی سحر دختر آبی به شوکه افتاد و در واقع این صحنه و این اتفاق نشون داد که زندگی دخترها و زنها تو ایران در چه شرایطیه، چطوری مردم زندگی میکنن که به خاطر دیدن یه مسابقه فوتبال باید به دادگاه کشیده بشن، باید تحت تعقیب قرار بگیرن، زندانی بشن و در واقع انسان رو به جایی بکشونن که مجبور شد که خودشو بکشه.
و وقتی که فقط به همین کیس نگاه میکنین واقعا میبینین که چقدر این سیستم جمهوری اسلامی ضد انسانیه. یه دختر رو به خاطر اینکه میخواد مثلا تیم استقلال رو ببینه، تیم مورد علاقهش رو بره ببینه، بازداشت میکنن، زندانیش میکنن، با قید وثیقه تازه فقط آزاد میشه، بعد میخوان بیان دادگاهیش کنن و خب بهش میگن که امکان داره 6 ماه به بالا زندانی بشی به خاطر همینی که اومدی و به قول اونا عفت عمومی رو زیر پا گذاشتی.
دقیقاً وقتی شما میبینین که چطوری جمهوری اسلامی مورد در واقع هجوم مخالفت مردم قرار میگیره، اولین کاری که میتونه حقیقت واقعیت رو بر اکشن جلو بده. سخنگوی قوه قضاییه غلام حسین اسماعیلی میاد توی تلویزیون مطرح میکنه تو مصاحبه، میگه اصلا چنین پرونده‌ای وجود نداشته، بعد شروع میکنه به چیز کردن، شروع میکنه به تخریب کردن
شخصیت
این خانم که دو قطبی بوده، پدر و مادرش گفتن اصلا نمیخواستن برن اینجا و ابراز ندامت کرده در این
کرده به
دقیقاً، و میگن ابراز ندامت کرده از اون کاری که، پس اگه چنین پرونده‌ای نبوده چطوری این ابراز ندامت کرده؟ و واقعا دروغگویی غلام حسین اسماعیلی تو روز روشن معلومه که این کارو دارن میکنن
و واقعا غیر انسانی بودنشون. ببینین مثلا همین مسئله که وقتی که درگذشت سحر عزیزمون توی بیمارستان، برای مثال بعد رفتن یواشکی دفنش کردن و حتی مدتی چند روز بعد بود که اخبارش به بیرون رسید و روی خانوادش فشار آوردن که صحبتی نشه در رابطه این، به خاطر اینکه دشمنان ایران میان حالا از این قضیه سوء استفاده میکنن. واقعیتش اینه که تنها دشمنان مردم ایران خود این جمهوری اسلامی
و قوانینشه
که انقدر ضد انسانی و انقدر ضد انسانی برخورد میکنن دقیقا. با همین یک نفر
کسی
حالا بقیه رو
کسی هم نمیخواد در واقع توی خود جمهوری اسلامی و تمام صفوفش از رفرمیستا و غیره بخواد انگوش بذاره روی جوهر جمهوری اسلامی و قوانینش. شما داشتین مطرح میکردین که چطوری مسئولین جمهوری اسلامی حتی اونا که ظاهرا رفرمیستان چه چیزایی میگفتن.
دقیقا مثلا میدونیم که خانم پروانه سلاشوری برای مثال گفته بود که یه جای گفته بود که خب این مثلا مردانن که اینو قبول نمی کنن و بعدم گفته بود که ما همه مسئول سحرها هستیم. نه خیر، ماها همه مسئول سحرها نیستیم، رژیم خود شماست که مسئول سحرهاست و مرگ همین سحر خدایاری عزیزمون هست. یکی از نمایندگان مجلس دیگه که به اصطلاح اصلاح طلبه، خود خانم طیبه سیاوشی مثلا میگفت که این مسائل فرهنگیه، نمیدونم چرا همه دنیا میخوان هی دخالت کنن تو مسائل فرهنگی ایران. خب این مسائل فرهنگی نیست، چون قبل از اینکه جمهوری اسلامی بیاد سر کار زنا میرفتن استادیوم‌های ورزشی تو همه دنیا به غیر از جمهوری اسلامی، زنا اجازه دارن برن توی ورزشگاه‌های ورزشی، استادیوم ورزشی فوتبال نگاه کنن. پس مشکل فرهنگ مردم نیست، مشکل فرهنگ جمهوری اسلامی قوانین خود جمهوری اسلامی
دقیقا و تلاش میکنن که حقوق زنان رو حاشیه نشون بدن، میگن مسائل مهمتری وجود داره، مسئله رشد خانواده وجود داره، مسئله این که زنا بتونن مثلا حقوق داشته باشن، حقوق منظورش که مقدار پول بیشتری بگیرن، این مسائل انحرافی مثل حقوق زنان، رفتن به ورزشگاه، مثل کودک همسر، اینا مهم نیست و اینا نیروهای خارجی هستن که دارن این کارو میکنن.
واقعیتش اینه که این رفتن توی استادیوم آزادی فقط در رابطه با تماشا کردن فوتبال نیست، این مسئله عمیقا برمیگرده به حق و حقوق انسان و اینکه زن و مرد با هم برابر باشن. یعنی واقعیتش اینه که مسئله است، اینکه زن بتونه هر چی که میخواد بپوشه، حجاب به سر نکنه اگر میخواد، بخواد بره تیم فوتبال تماشا کنه، نخواد بره استادیوم فوتبال، این تصمیم و حق خود زنه و این برمیگرده به عمق مسئله برابری بین مرد و زن. میدونم یه سری آدما میگن که خب اگر زنا بتونن وارد استودیوم بشن، آیا شما اجازه میدین زنت یا مادرت یا خواهرت وارد استودیوم بشه؟ ببخشید، ملک شما که نیست، ملک مردان که نیستن زنان. یعنی آدما استقلال خودشونو دارن، همونطوری که مرد پا میشه تصمیم میگیره که امروز میخوام برم وارد استودیوم بشم، تیم مورد علاقه‌مو نگاه کنم، بازی رو تماشا کنم، یه زنم همون حقو داره مثل هر چیز دیگه.
و خیلی جالبه که جامعه ایران خواهان برابری زن و مرده. نگاه کنین توی مسابقه فوتبال مردم چی میگن. این خواست برابری زن و مرد خودشو تلاقی میده و نشون میده توی حق رفتن به استادیوم و تماشای فوتبال و جامعه ایران خواهان برابری زن و مرد هست بر علیه جمهوری اسلامی. تیم استقلال وقتی رفتن اولین بازیشون که رفتن، مخفیانه مجبور شدن یه تیشرت بکنن تنشون به یاد سحر و دختر آبی، یادش رو گرامی بدارن، در حالی که این با مخالفت شدید جمهوری اسلامی و کیهان جمهوری اسلامی و تمام روزنامه ها و مطبوعات فاشیستی اسلامی مورد حمله قرار گرفتن. و این خواست آزادی، در واقع خواست آزادی خواست عمیق جامعه ایرانه.
این مسئله خیلی عمیق‌تر از فقط رفتن به استادیوم آزادی و فوتبال تماشا کردنه. خب میدونین این مسئله برمیگرده همونطوری که قبلا هم گفتم به برابری بین مرد و زن و در ضمن علیه جداسازی جنسیه. وقتی که مرد و زن رو از هم جدا میکنین در ملأ عام، دلیلش خیلی بیشتر از اینیه که حالا مثلا مسئله فوتباله، جداسازی از حجاب اجباری گرفته تا اینکه زنا باید از درای متفاوت وارد مثلا ادارات دولتی بشن، یا اینکه اون ور دریا شنا کنن یا کوها رو جدا میکنن وقتی زن و مرد میخوان اسکی کنن. برای مثال میخوام بگم این جدا سازی ها برای حفاظت از زن نیست، برای کنترل زنانه، برای اینکه زنان رو سرکوب کنه و اینکه بگه زن با مرد مساوی نیست. یعنی خیلی عمیق‌تر از این چیزاست و به همین دلیل باید مقابله بشه با این نوع قوانین و این نوع جداسازی.
دقیقا شما نگاه میکنید میبینید که این تبعیض بین زن و مرد یکی از مهمترین و از بین بردن تبعیض بین زن و مرد یکی از مهمترین دستاوردهای بشر بوده. دیگه تمام سازمانهای بین المللی دنیا رو هم اینا قبول کردن. خود فیفا یکی از قوانین اصلیش اینه که در فوتبال و در ورزش نمیشه بین زن و مرد تبعیض قرار داد. من نمیدونم چطوری فیفا هنوز که هنوز بعد از 40 سال تحمل میکنه اینو. چقدر مردم برن پتیشن بدن به فیفا، چقدر مردم اعتراض بکنن، چقدر جمهوری اسلامی دروغ بگه به اینا. شب روز آقای روحانی، آقای تمام سران جمهوری اسلامی دارن اعلام میکنن که بابا جان مخالف حضور زنان در جمهوری، در حضور زنان در استادیوم در جمهوری، تحت حکومت جمهوری اسلامی هستن. هنوز که هنوز رئیس فیفا بلند میشه میره پیرهن به رئیس جمهور ایران میده که اسم روحانی روش نوشته. واقعا شرم‌آوره. الان هم نماینده فیفا اومده گفته که ما میخوایم بریم در همین آینده، بعد از اینکه تحت فشار عمومی قرار گرفته، ما میخوایم بریم ایران رو دیدار کنیم، ببینیم میشه در واقع بررسی کنیم احتمال ورود زنان بسیدیم. بعد از 40 سال آخه
هنوزم همیشه هم همین حرف رو میزنن و قرار نیست کاری هم بکنن جز اینکه فشار اینقدر شدید باشه که مجبور بشن یک عکس العملی نشون بدن. جز به قوانین خودشون، اولا اگر کسایی مثلا کسایی که سیاه پوست بودن اجازه نداشتن وارد استادیوم فوتبال بشن به خاطر اینکه سیاه پوستن، یا اگر کسایی توی مثلا اروپا اجازه ورود به استادیوم نداشتن چون مسلمان بودن، یا به خاطر اینکه پناهنده بودن، یا به خاطر اینکه مثلا همجنسگرا بودن، اصلا یه لحظه نمیشد که فیفا اینو اجازه بده. ولی وقتی که به زن میاد همیشه حاضرن عقب نشینی کنن. فیفا میگه که میدونیم که یک نگرانی های فرهنگی وجود داره. کجاش فرهنگی؟ مگه مردم ایران اینقدر بی فرهنگن که زن و مرد نمیتونن بغل هم تو استادیوم فوتبال بشینن؟ چطور توی اروپا توی کشورهای دیگه زنان ایرانی وارد استودیوم ها میشن بغل مردان ایرانی میشینن هیچ اتفاقی نمیفته، ولی تو ایران حالا این یه نوع فرهنگای مشکلات فرهنگی که هست که اینا نگرانشن. یعنی فرهنگ جمهوری اسلامی رو میخوان بهش احترام بزنن و در این حال بی احترامی کنن به زن و مرد ایرانی.
و خیلی جالبه، نگاه کنین در همین هفته گذشته زمانی که سازمان بین‌المللی و فدراسیون بین‌المللی جودو ایران رو از این فدراسیون بیرون کرده تا یا در واقع کنار گذاشته تا زمانی که قوانین تبعیض بر علیه یهودی‌ها و دولت اسرائیل و بازیکن‌های اسرائیلی رو چیز کنه، کنار بذاره. به خاطر که جمهوری اسلامی تلاش کرده بود در مسابقات جودو کاری بکنه که مثلا با جودو کار ایرانی و جودو کار اسرائیلی مثلا چیز نکنن، رقابت نکنن، و به درستی این فدراسیون جمهوری اسلامی بیرون کرد. پس امکان پذیره، امکان پذیره و کار خیلی زیادی هم نمیخواد انجام بده. ولی نگاه کنین که وقتی به حقوق زنان میرسه، زنان توی ایران تحت قوانین اسلامی، نگاه کنین رئیس فدراسیون همین آقایی که میخواد بره ایران، نگاه کنین چی
clear that politics should stay out of football and football should stay out of politics, but they should mix. I mean there are of course political issues between countries all over the world, but this should not have an impact on football tournaments. On the contrary, football should be there and is there for all the people, for all the people in Iran, for all the people in Saudi Arabia, for all the people in every country in the world. Obviously, you know, the guarantees must be there, the safety must be there, everything must be clear. But I will talk with whoever I can talk to make sure that we can make the people everywhere happy and that football wins at the end of the day. And the political issues, they can remain and they can be sorted out by somebody else. We will sort out.
می‌بینین که وقتی به حقوق انسان، حقوق زن میرسه، مسئله سیاسی میشه. خود فدراسیون جمهوری اسلامی، فدراسیون فیفا و فوتبال تحت فشار الان و بعد تحت فشار بیشتری قرار بگیره، مجبور بشه جمهوری اسلامی رو بیرون بکنه تا زمانی که تبعیض بر علیه زنان تو ایران از بین نره. نگاه کنین جمهوری اسلامی حاضر به سازش نیست. تلاش نکنین باش سازش بکنین، بعد بیرونش کنین.
اگر فلون جو ظاهر نشید، فلون فدراسیونت بین المللی، فلان تشکیلات بین المللی از شما ناراضی میشه، به درک که ناراضی میشه. هیچ غلطی نمیتونن بکنن.
ببینین رئیس دزدا میاد میگه پاتون ننرزونی تحت فشار سازمان های بین المللی قرار نگیره. منظورش در واقع سازمان های بین المللی نیست، میدونه اونا هیچ بخاری ندارن، منظورش فشار جامعه مردم ایرانه که تحت منگنه مردم ایران و فشار منگنه ایران گرفتن. ولی اینو باید بدونن که مردم ایران دنبال ایران اومدن و تا زمانی که تبعیض علیه زن و مرد از بین نره از پا نخواهند نشست.
یه واقعیت اینه که خب متاسفانه یک عزیز سحر خدایاری رو از دست دادیم، یعنی جامعه ایران از دست داد، یه زنی که حالا دارن سعی میکنن 1001 ترور شخصیتی بکنن، میخوام بگن روانی بوده، دو قطبی بوده و غیره. خب این اولا یه زنیه که دوتا لیسانس دانشگاهی داره، زنیه که در حالی که میدونست نمیتونه، اجازه نداره قانونن وارد استودیو بشه، میخواست از حق خودش دفاع کنه و جداسازی جنسی رو از بین ببره. و خب این یه واقعیتی که همیشه در طول تاریخ در رابطه با زنان معترض گفتن جادوگرن، روانیان، مریضن، احساساتیان و غیره. و چیزی که واقعیت داره اینه که این زنای معترض نیستن که روانیان، این سیستمشه که روانیه، جمهوری اسلامی که واقعا غیر انسانی، ضد بشریه. و در احترام و در یادبود سحر خدایاری به نظرم ما باید تمام تلاشمون رو بکنیم که این قوانین رو از بین ببریم. این با فشار مردم ایران، مردم جهان میتونه به یه واقعیت تبدیل بشه. Program. I wanted to speak to you about your YouTube channel, which is quite well known. It focuses on making fun of religion and also religious figures. Tell me about that. Why you think that's important?
So I think for me, someone who's been very much interested in Islam, very much interested in debates as well, I found that there was a dearth or a lack of comedy within the whole scene. So it's one thing to criticize Islam or religion in general, but it's one thing to ridicule and to show people how silly the ideas are through comedy. So I was interested in comedy, I was interested in drama, so I thought why not satirize and make fun of some of the more popular speakers within Islam and maybe sort of expose the irrational beliefs in religion through comedy. So I think it's important to do that because that's one of the things that they don't like. Anyone, any sort of dictator or any person who does not like being questioned hates ridicule because it shows people how silly their views are.
And I mean, ridicule is sort of really goes to the core of things, doesn't it? And that's why it's so frowned upon. And also there's so many laws against it.
Exactly. I mean, if you want to speak about blasphemy law through the government or even in general society, people don't approve of you making fun of either religion or certain political figures that are very powerful and don't want their authority questioned. But if you're someone who's sincere and is looking for the truth, then if someone says, don't make fun of me, then you say, well, why not? What do you have to hide? Especially if you want my devotion and power and my money or sort of anything. If you're asking me for something, then I have a right to question you and I have a right to make fun of you. And if someone says, no, you can't, then that's a very big red flag for me.
There's another comedian of Muslim background. She sort of says that comedy breaks through the fear because if you can laugh, it doesn't have the same hold on you.
Exactly. That's a very good point because I remember in one of my videos I made fun of the whole Day of Judgment, the sort of Imam Mahdi coming and this whole doomsday scenario. I actually made fun of that in one of my videos and someone who was a Muslim commented below saying, I used to be so scared of this, but now I can't take it seriously anymore because now you've shown me how silly these things are, that the Mahdi will come, the earth will be upside down and people will be, this is silly, this is like from a movie, you know. And I think that comedian is completely right. Once you make people laugh, you make them realize that this is all nonsense.
What is the funniest things that you think you've done, like what things you really love from the videos you've made?
It's a tough one because I think I've done so many different types of videos. People have their own favorites. But one of the biggest favorites is Dr. Zakir Naik, who is this sort of one of the biggest Muslim speakers in the world from India. And he was very, or he has been very successful. You know, he draws big crowds to his events. And I started impersonating him just sort of as a joke, not even taking it seriously, but people really responded to that. So I'm the first, or one of the first videos I made was saying why nursery rhymes are haram. So, you know, I picked a few nursery rhymes like Jack and Jill went up the hill. And then he said, well, why are they going together? You know, there should be no intermingling between the, you know, all this kind of genders. And Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. This is referring to horoscopes and Islam. Horoscopes are haram. And this little piggy went to the market. Of course, pigs are haram and all this kind of stuff. So when you start taking normal things like nursery rhymes and imposing that sort of Islamic doctrine or that very rigid way of looking at the haram, halal, haram, you realize, you know, what's going on here? This is nonsense. You know, so I actually enjoy putting the religious on the mundane and showing people how silly this is. That's what I enjoy. Yeah.
And you mentioned your first video I read somewhere was about five things you need to be a sheikh.
How to become a sheikh. Yeah. Five easy steps.
So tell us about those easy steps.
So, I have, when I was Muslim, I watched so many different videos of sheikhs, like Sufi, Sunni, Shia, Salafi, all different types of sheikhs, and even sort of modern reformists. And I found that there was like a formula almost to becoming a good sheikh. It was so formulaic. So I said, you know, I've seen so many videos on how to lose weight or how to do this or how to do your hair like this. What about how to become a sheikh? So I picked five steps on how to become a sheikh. First, you've got to pick a title, you know, Imam, Mufti, Maulana, whatever. And then you've got to pick your persona. Are you the cool sheikh, or are you the harsh sheikh, or are you this and that? So for me, when I did that, that's my Bible. That's my sort of foundation. If you want to know what video is about, watch that video, because it's what you see is patterns emerging from all the different sheikhs. It's very formulaic. And once you recognize those patterns, you can break it down. And you can really break down their whole sort of this big aura they have around themselves, that they've got this turban, they've got this beard, and you're scared of them. No, this is very formulaic, and it's almost like they're factory produced, you know? So that's what it is.
So you were Muslim at one point,
yep.
And then, of course, you're an agnostic atheist now.
Yep.
Were you ever scared of making fun? And what changed?
So even when I was a Muslim, I remember when Charlie Hebdo happened, and I was just thinking, like, even the Muslims around me, who obviously don't condone the violence, even they were upset and they were like, oh, you know, they shouldn't have made fun of the Prophet and they shouldn't have drawn cartoons. But I was like, if I'm a Muslim and I believe in this religion and I have faith, why would stupid jokes or cartoons or anything like that, why would they hurt me? Or why would they offend me to the point where I now have to kill someone or be violent towards someone? So that really annoyed me, that we have this brittleness within the Muslim community, that we can't take anything offensive, we can't take any jokes. So even as a Muslim, I wasn't scared of making jokes, because I thought my personal belief was stronger than anyone's joke or cartoon. So obviously when I left Islam, this was one of my own personal projects, that I have to sort of encourage Muslims to laugh at themselves. Even if you remain Muslim and have very strong faith and belief in your religion, that doesn't mean if someone draws a cartoon, now you have to erupt with anger. Now you can't talk to them. Now you can't do whatever it is. So this has been my personal project, that I want Muslims to be able to laugh at themselves and encourage a healthy debate and discussion, and to revive this tradition of ridicule. Because we ridicule our politicians, we ridicule our celebrities, we ridicule everyone, just like everyone else. But when it comes to religion, we're very hush-hush. And I think anyone who's asking power from you, you should have a very healthy level of skepticism and ridicule.
I mean, this is also relatively more recent with the rise of Islamism, because there is a long history of ridicule
exactly.
and mocking religion. So you're basically just doing what's been done historically.
I'm not doing anything new. In fact, I would say I'm reviving, like you said, an old tradition that existed in many Muslims' lands of sort of lampooning the sheikh or making fun of the Maulana. And it was accepted, you know, fine, they were religious people. But, you know, at the same time, they're like, this guy shakes a bit dodgy or he's a bit funny. I remember one, I think it was Pervez Hoodboy, saying that, you know, in the sort of early days of Pakistan, like, it was a normal thing to make fun of the Maulana. You know, it was a normal thing. But then, I think after the 70s, Now the Maulana's got status, you can't question him, you can't touch him, and he's very, you know, people are very scared to point fingers. But this was something which was, I mean, this is not even that long ago. People used to make fun of the Sheikh. So, and they were still Muslim, so I don't see why it can't happen today.
Do you think there's a limit to comedy, though? Like, do you think, I mean, how far do you think people are allowed to go? Is there a limit?
This is a question which is very hotly debated nowadays, especially with sort of political correctness. I mean, even not with Islam, just like, can you make fun of, I don't know, the gender differences or different races or different things and so on and so forth. For me, number one thing is, what is your intention and who is your audience? If the audience knows that you're just making fun of even a very serious topic, but you're sort of just trying to maybe point out the silliness in human beings, I have no problem with that. And the limit, I mean, how do you know you've got to the limit? The only way you know is when you've crossed it. So you've got to, so comedy is actually quite brave. You've got to be brave in the sense that you know this joke could make someone laugh, or it could be like, oh, did that guy go too far? But you don't know until you've gone there. So I would say the comedians should be allowed to explore, and the people watching their comedy should give them some leniency, because one joke they might get it 100% right, the other joke they might fall flat on their face. But obviously, with any speech, the limit is you cannot draw to violence. You can't say we need to get these people or kill them or take away their rights, that kind of stuff. So
that's not really free speech anymore, is it?
That's not free speech anymore.
To violence.
Exactly. Well, you've crossed that line then.
But is there a limit to criticizing religion? An idea?
Ideas for me are free game, because I say, if you know any idea, whether it's political or religious, they have a certain view of the world. If they want me to accept it, then they have to convince me. I have a right to give them my view of their view. And if I do it through debate, through writing articles, through movies, through comedy, that's completely fine. So there's no limit in terms of ridiculing religion or any capitalism, communism, whatever ism or schism. You should have every right to criticize and ridicule.
What about, have you done videos on criticizing Islam itself, verses or the Hadith?
My main focus has been things like apostasy law, blasphemy law. I have criticized Islam when it comes to scientific miracles. For me, that was actually one of the main reasons why I actually left Islam, because I tried really hard to reconcile science and religion. And obviously, you know, someone like Zakir Naik, he was saying that, you know, science and religion are compatible, the scientific miracles. But obviously, the deeper I researched, I found out this was not true. So I have touched upon science, I have touched upon blasphemy, I have touched upon apostasy, I even touched upon Muslims, they say that the Bible prophesies Muhammad and all this kind of, that's not even true, because they had no idea who Muhammad was. Of course, the Bible and Torah are false themselves, but even then there is some sort of integrity within those scriptures. So I have actually done that as well, and those videos actually came later, but my main thrust has been comedy.
So, I mean, just, I suppose, as a final question, I mean, this importance of laughing at silly ideas and also laughing at yourself.
100%.
You mentioned that. Why is that so key for any sort of change in the world, in your opinion? Like, why do you do it?
I think laughing and humor is some sort of evolutionary mechanism. Human beings have, I mean, we spoke about comedy and we spoke about, is there a limit? I mean, in Europe, the overwhelming sort of history of comedy has been Jewish people, Jewish comedians, and they've been through, you know, hell, you know, whether it's the Holocaust or even before that, and they ridicule themselves all the time. And in fact, they said this is a coping mechanism, that in this life that we have so much struggles and pain, one of the ways to get through it is by laughing at ourselves. And I think, you know, every community, every individual goes through many ups and downs, hardships. But there's no reason why we can't take a step back and say, isn't it kind of funny or silly that this is situation that we're in, and we try and do one thing and something else happens and so on and so forth. So, you know, life is funny. You know, it can be sad, it can be amazing, but it's also funny. And I don't see why we should deny ourselves that dimension of our lives from an individual level or on a community or humanitarian level. And I think it's a great coping mechanism.
Sorry, one more question.
Go for it.
The last question I'd like to ask is, I mean, What about, you know, those who say you shouldn't be offending, and comedy can be really offensive, you know?
Yeah, so being exposed to offensive jokes, offensive material, offensive ideas is part of your intellectual development. The same way you go into the gym, the next day you're sore, you should also have those mental calluses that how am I going to get over this? You expose yourself to new ideas, you know, as challenge yourself and challenge other people. That's how you're going to get through this. And that's how you're going to reach the truth, whatever that is.
We've come too far to give up on a mark. So let's raise the bar and our hands to the stars. She's up all night to the sun. I'm listening to the azan. She don't do any haram. I'm up all night to Petrawi. We're up all night to the sun. We're listening to the azan. We don't do any haram. We're up all night to Petrawi. 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 Thank you.